This is Jeremiah 51:3. Against him that bendeth, let the archer bend his bow, and against him that lifteth himself up in his brigandine, and spare ye not her young men, destroy ye utterly all her hosts. Commanding all nuclear capable nations at the Lord's appointed time to fire all their arrows, their nuclear weapons upon her, Babylon the Great, aka America, sparing none. None shall escape. Giving all praises, glory, and honor unto YAHAWAH, BAHASHAM, YAHAWASHI. 2 Edges 16:13, for strong is his right hand, the Lord's right hand, YAHAWAH being the Father, and his right hand being his only begotten Son, even his expressed image. For at his day will these missiles fly and hit their mark and will not miss. For strong is his right hand that bendeth the bow. His arrows that he shooteth are sharp. For these nuclear weapons are the Lord's weapons, the weapons of his indignation, and shall not miss when they begin to be shot into the ends of the world. Let me read that again. For strong is his right hand that bendeth the bow. His arrows that he shooteth are sharp and shall not miss when they begin to be shot into the ends of the world. Intercontinental ballistic missiles, hypersonic missiles that are undetected, will be shot on the Lord's day to destroy utterly Babylon the Great and other nations destined to be hit, and the earth shall rock to and fro like a drunkard. Enjoy the clip. As the scripture said, spare ye not her young men. All right, spare no arrows. Shoot. All right, let's get that in Jeremiah real quick. Where is that? Yep, we already read it. The archer bend his bow. Spare no arrows. It's all good. Spare ye not her young men. All right, let's get up out of there. A desolation. Giving all praises, glory, and honor unto YAHAWAH, BAHASHAM, YAHAWASHI, BAHASHAM, RAWCHAA, QADASH, which is the Holy Spirit by whom we do function. Giving double honors unto my apostles, my elders, and my teachers at Great Millstone that are ruling well and continue to do so. Salutations, peace, and blessings unto the hopeful elect at House of David. To you brothers out there fighting this good fight of faith, Shalawam. To you sisters doing that which is becoming of women, Shalawam. And to those that are addicted unto this ministry, I say, Shalawam. This finally is, as the thief in the night, part 3, the unexpected. All right, and I'm going to bring out that article. All right, giving double honors once again unto my teachers, the apostles and elders at Great Millstone that taught me and brothers like me and you believers this truth, this beautiful truth, beginning with the names of our power and of his anointed. Now these are the two most important things you could ever and will ever know. The name of the Heavenly Father and the name of his only begotten Son, to call upon and be saved in these last and troubling days, and to be preserved from the evils. Now these be the names that are written. The name of the Heavenly Father is YAHAWAH. YAH meaning he, HAWA meaning exists or is or is to be. He is, he exists. He, the existing one. For he is a rewarder of them that diligently seeks him. That's what his name means. He is. He exists. right? And in the name of his only begotten son, a name that is above every name given amongst men here on earth to the Israelite man first, and also to the believers consisting of women, children, helps of the prophets and those that have faith, even the name, even the mighty name of YAHAWASHI. Yah, meaning he, HAWASHI, meaning deliverer and savior. For that is exactly what he will come and do for the second time in physical form, yet as an angelic force, and we shall see him as he is, and we shall be like him. So, Lord's willing, this is an edifying lesson. As I stated before, this is As a Thief in the Night, The Unexpected, Part 3. Now, this is the book of Psalm, chapter 46 and 8. Come, behold, the works of the Lord, YAHAWAH BAHASHAM YAHAWASHI, what desolations he hath made in the earth. And the exact precept to this is that the earth shall rock to and fro like a drunkard, and the earth shall be burned, and few men left. Those are the desolations that shall be done in the earth. Come and behold what desolations he hath made in the earth, YAHAWAH BAHASHAM YAHAWASHI. This is Psalm 73:19. How are they brought into desolation as in a moment? They are utterly consumed with terrors, going into our enemies. They're going to be utterly consumed with terrors, for the king of terrors shall bring upon them their destruction. Okay? Man, Proverbs, let's go to, Proverbs 3:25. Be not afraid of sudden fear, neither of the desolation of the wicked when it cometh. For the elect has nothing to worry about. We shall be protected and preserved, all right, and kept from the second death. Upon the elect, the second death, which is the nuclear holocaust, shall have no power. All right. Isaiah 10:3. And what will ye do in the day of visitation and in the desolation which shall come from far? Going into those missiles are going to come from a far country, from the end of heaven, to make the whole land desolate. The land of America and other lands destined to be hit, but all of America will be utterly destroyed. It says, and what will ye do in the day of visitation and in the desolation which shall come from far? To whom will ye flee for help, and where will ye leave your glory? See that? Man. Isaiah 17:9, in that day shall his strong cities be as a forsaken bough and an uppermost branch. And this is beautiful because it connects with Job, where it says, it shall go ill with him that is left in his habitation. Fire and brimstone shall be scattered upon his habitation, going into the elements found in the nuclear weaponry. All right, you see how my man Achilles was unable to escape, got shot through that heel, even though old girl cried out for him. No, got shot and kept getting shot. That's what the Lord's going to do to Babylon the Great, going to overkill this place. All right, just how they be shooting Jake down the streets and Jake already be well and gone. Well, the Lord's going to do that to Babylon and Esau, Edom, the self-proclaimed white man. His power structure and his might and all the nation's armies will be turned to dust and smoke by way of our power, YAHAWAH, through his son, YAHAWASHI, our Lord and our Savior, that great one, our deliverer and Redeemer. It says, in that day shall his strong cities be as a forsaken bough and an uppermost branch, which they left because of the children of Israel, and there shall be desolation. All right. Man, this is even before the missiles hit. Babylon the Great is going to be smitten with plagues. It says, in the city is left desolation. And the gate, which is the leadership, is smitten with destruction. All right? This is when the YAHAWASHI arrives. Hey, the leadership is going to be through, and the nation's defense is going to be utterly destroyed. Because a nation's defense is their military, their army. And YAHAWASHI is going to make quick work of their forces in the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And Michael is going, with the angels, are going to make quick work of that space force. All right, and there's going to be no place found for them in heaven. They will have no rulership. All right, this is Isaiah 47:11. At this time, Babylon the Great is already in the dust and confusion. and only more and more evil will come upon it until its destruction. Isaiah 47:11, therefore shall evil come upon thee, talking about America, Babylon the Great, thou shalt not know from whence it riseth. Mischief shall fall upon thee, thou shalt not be able to put it off. And desolations shall come upon thee suddenly, which thou shalt not know. Hence, as a thief in the night, the unexpected, those missiles hitting unexpectedly and unaware. I just like my man Achilles was unaware until he was hit. But then when he finally seen where it was coming from, it was far too late. All right. Isaiah 51:19. These two things are come unto thee. Who shall be sorry for thee? Desolation and destruction, and the famine and the sword. By whom shall I comfort thee? Man, sit. Call Ayim La Yabashim Al Shai. Alright? These things are going to come unto America unexpectedly. Desolation, destruction. Famine is already going to be in the land. Lack of resources. Babylon is going to be cut off. Trade routes are going to be cut. When war breaks out, trade routes are cut off. Gates are closed. Alright? In the ancient world, since gates are closed during warfare. Alright? It says, all right, I believe that was it. Yep. Okay. It's going into Israel being rebuilt. Okay, let's go down into Jeremiah. Okay. Bear with me, brothers. Gonna get some more here. We'll start right here in Jeremiah 40:4-22. Now this had pertained to the nation of Israel, but now this pertains to Babylon the Great, aka America. All right, because this place has done far worse than Israel ever did when we were in the land. All right, at least the nation of Israel was trying to keep the ways of the Lord and failed because we're in this flesh. But this place is altogether went against the Heavenly Father. All right, and his son, and all that is right. And that's why the Lord is going to destroy it in such a way. It's Jeremiah 44:22. So that the Lord, Yahweh Bashem Hashai, could no longer bear because of the evil of your doings and because of the abominations which you have committed. Therefore is your land a desolation and an astonishment and a curse without an inhabitant. As at this day. And that's what's going to happen to Babylon. Because Jerusalem, Israel, is going to be inhabited again. Okay, by its true people, its inhabitants. But America will never be inhabited again. By humans, by people. But desert creatures, after the smoke clears, will occupy this land. This is Jeremiah 49:13. For I have sworn by myself, saith the Lord, that Bozrah should become a desolation, a reproach, a waste, and a curse. And all the cities thereof shall be perpetual wastes. Woo! See, the Lord have sworn by himself that Bozrah, which is the ancient capital city of Edom, but modern day Bozrah is America. All right? Woo, man. And if it wasn't enough, the Lord is mentioning Edom again. Jeremiah 49:17. Also, Edom shall be a desolation. Everyone that goeth by it shall be astonished and shall hiss at all the plagues thereof. As the plagues are going to hit Edom, the people of Edom, self-proclaimed white people, even before the missiles, the noise and pestilence finishes you off and the lasers from the ships, the plagues that hit Egypt, and even newer plagues, new signs will the Lord show. As is recorded in the book of the Apocrypha, Ecclesiastes, Lord show new signs. Lord is going to show new signs and is going to destroy you wonderfully. Then end you with missiles and laser fire. All right? Spirit. All right? Now this is Jeremiah 49:33. And Hazar shall be a dwelling for dragons and a desolation, another name for America. because we're going to go into Hazar and what it was, its importance, its significance in the scriptures. Because another name for America is Nineveh. Nineveh was overthrown and prophesied against by Jonah. Egypt was plagued and destroyed, prophesied against by Moses and Aaron, which America is known as Egypt, is known as Nineveh, is known as Hazar, and also is known as Babylon, Babylon the Great, because it was mentioned in Jeremiah and other books that Babylon the Great, another Babylon, was going to be destroyed and thrown down and destroyed by fire. Ancient Babylon, it was just a transition of power, but yet there was a writing on the wall, and that its end was also prophesied by Daniel. So this is like the same recurring story. The prophets rise up. The Lord is angry. That place is prophesied against. Then it is overthrown. See? And that's America's end. All right. It says, and Hazar shall be a dwelling for dragons and a desolation forever. Woo! There shall no man abide there, nor any son of man dwell in it. That's it. Man. Now let's read Jeremiah 50 and 23. How is the hammer of the whole earth cut asunder and broken? Babylon the Great, a.k.a. America. It was a military force to be reckoned with. But how is it broken? As is mentioned in this scripture. How is Babylon, America, become a desolation among the nations? Question. So with that, hey, bear with me, bear with me. One moment. All right, I'm back. Akim, now we read that scripture that had Hazar in it, and it says it's going to be desolate forever, right? Ooh, and a place for dragons. Now let's get Hazar in the scriptures. It was first mentioned in the book of Joshua, all right, 11 and 1, but let's go into what Joshua actually did to that city. All right, now this is Joshua 11 and 10. And it says, and Joshua at that time turned back and took Hazar. Ooh, hey. And that's the spirit, because YAHAWASHI is first going to make his appearance in the east, in the valley of Jehoshaphat, where our land is, the Saudi Arabian Peninsula, near the Persian Gulf, right there. That's where the armies are going to be duking it out, fighting. And then the Lord is going to appear. All right. And destroy the armies of the world in that place. And nothing will be perceived but dust and smell of smoke. Then the Lord is going to make his way here. He's going to travel west and spread his wings, which is his chariot, the fathership, over Basra, which is America. As it tells you in another place. All right. It says, and Joshua at that time turned back and took Hazar. See, the Lord is going to take America and smote the king thereof with the sword. For Hazar, before time, was the head of all those kingdoms. See, America was the head of all these kingdoms. But how has it become a desolation in a moment? All right? How is it smitten? Joshua 11 and 11. A double destruction. Hey, because 11, you know, numerically, it goes into destruction. But that's for another time. All right? It says, and they smote all the souls. This is what the army of Israel did. Within this particular city when we were taking our land. And they smote all the souls that were therein with the edge of the sword, utterly destroying them. There was not any left to breathe. And he burnt Hazar with fire. Woo, and that's what the Lord is going to do with the lasers, with the missiles as an army, leaping over the walls, coming into the city, spoiling, and with the angels in them. All right, so the missiles, the laser fire from the ships, the Lord himself and the angels are going to utterly destroy. All right, but the missiles, as that army is going to smite all the souls that are therein. All right, nothing is going to be left breathing and is going to be burnt with fire. Man, the Lord's going to slay utterly old and young. In this place, in Babylon the Great, a.k.a. America. This is Joshua 11 and 13. But as for the cities that stood still in their strength. Now, when America goes down, the other nations are going to see its destruction. And they're going to be still somewhat in their strength, still intact. But their destruction is going to be imminent and inevitable. Why? Because those that survive will be put into slavery and captivity. All right. The earth is going to be decimated because of the destruction. All right. And then they themselves as a sovereign nation will be no more again. It says, but as for the cities that stood still in their strength, Israel burned none of them save Hazar only. That did Joshua burn. See, now you can relay this of what YAHAWASHI is going to do. Now, Babylon the Great, America is going to be utterly destroyed. Other places are going to be hit, yes, but Babylon is going to be utterly destroyed, never to rise again. What was will never be again at that moment and at that time. Like, whoa, because the land of Israel is going to be rebuilt and all these other nations are going to be carted off into slavery. All right. And they're going to be put to work and they're going to be turned to where our land sits, where all the other nations' lands are. And they're going to be put to work. And after that 1,000 years, they're going to be granted their lands back. But they're going to be always and forever under the rule of YAHAWASHI, Israel. OK, now that was pretty much it, but let's get into this word Hazar, what it means in the Hebrew. And we're going to keep on going in this lesson. I'm going to get that article. All right, let's go to. Let's read in the NLT. Joshua then turned back and captured Hazar and killed its king. Hazar had at one time been the capital of all these kingdoms. Does that not remind you of America? Yes, it does. And that's what the YAHAWASHI is going to do. He's going to come, take the kings of this earth, which are going to be hiding in their underground military bases, and going to put them in slavery. And he's going to burn this city with fire and all places else that are destined to go up in flames. Now, the word there for Hazar, H2674, Khatazawar. And it is a dope name because it means castle or fortress, you know, fortified castle. It says a royal city of northern Palestine allotted to Naphtali. And that's beautiful because Naphtali means, is it my dwelling or my wrestling? Gotta remember. Is it my dwelling? I believe, yeah, my dwelling. Yep. My wrestling, I think, is another tribe, Zebi. Is it Zebulon? No. Zebulon is my dwelling, and Naphtali is my wrestling. So Lord had to wrestle with this place. He had to wrestle with Babylon, man. He had to bear it, the vessels fitted for destruction. But then soon the Lord will destroy this place. All right, this fortress, this defensed city. All right, so to speak, which has no defenses, is unwalled. All right, unwalled villages. All right, so it means castle. It's a fortress. All right, and that's what the Lord is going to do. He's going to burn this city. All right, let's get up out of there. We're going to keep on going. It's Jeremiah 51 and 43. Her cities are a desolation, a dry land and a wilderness, a land wherein no man dwelleth, neither doth any son of man pass thereby. And this is exactly what the Lord wants to do. And the Lord is going to do it and none will stop him. All right. Jeremiah 51, 29. I should have read this first. And the land shall tremble and sorrow for every purpose of the Lord YAHAWAH by BAHASHAM shall be performed against Babylon. To make the land of Babylon, which is America, a desolation without an inhabitant. Man. Woo. And I like in the clip, Troy was already on fire when my man was hit by that arrow, Achilles. So the world is already going to be on fire and flames and at war when the Lord YAHAWASHI arrives to shoot Babylon with those nuclear missiles. The world is already going to be at war. All right. Let's get up out of there. Let's go to Jeremiah. We're going to read in the modern translation. Jeremiah 51 going into these missiles destroying wind. All right. Now let's go into. Let's see here. Man, Ezekiel 35 and 9. I will make thee perpetual desolations, and thy city shall not return. And ye shall know that I am the Lord, YAHAWASHI. This place will never return. Esau, Edom, you and your cities will never again oppress. Alright, you will be destroyed. Joel 3:19. Egypt shall be a desolation. The modern day Egypt is America. Modern day Egyptian is the Edomite. You self-proclaimed white people. You Caucasians, you cave dwellers. Egypt shall be a desolation, and Edom shall be a desolate wilderness. They are one and the same. For the violence against the children of Judah, the so-called Negro Latino, or the so-called Negro, but you butchered and had violence against all the tribes, but preferably the head tribe, Judah, the so-called Negro. It says, for the violence against the children of Judah, so-called Negro, and even the kingdom of Judah, Judah, Benjamin, Levi, the so-called Negro, West Indian, and Haitian, but preferably the tribe of Judah, the so-called Negro. Because they have shed innocent blood in their land. You shed innocent blood in the land of America, and the only way it can be cleansed is by your blood being shed in the very land to make it right in the eyes of Yahweh, BAHASHAM, YAHWASHI. Zephaniah 1:15, that day is a day of wrath, the day of the Lord, a day of trouble and distress, a day of wasteness and desolation. Ooh, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds going into the chariots and thick darkness, because the chariots, the chariot that YAHWASHI is going to be on ultimately, and even the missiles when they hit and the smoke goes, that will blot out the heavenly bodies, the sun, the moon, and also representing the understanding and wisdom of this place will be blotted out in that day, because it will be a day not like no other and will never be again. And in the very same day, in our land, in that region, Gaza, right, Ashkelon, Ekron, and all those other cities of old will be utterly decimated as well. All right. But the difference is that they will be rebuilt. Zephaniah 2:4. For Gaza shall be forsaken, Ashkelon a desolation. They shall drive out Ashdod at the noonday, at the height of Esau Edom's power. These places shall be driven out and forsaken and destroyed. And Ekron shall be rooted up, because the missiles are going to hit those certain places. All right. In the very same day. All right. Now, this is Jeremiah 51:1. Babylon judged for sins against Israel. Thus saith the Lord YAHWH, BAHASHAM, YAHWASHI, behold, I will raise up against Babylon and against them that dwell in the midst of them that rise up against me, a destroying wind going into that nuclear wind. All right. Because when the blast, when it hits, the blast goes out. There's a flash, a quake, a rumbling, a wind. Then the smoke and the fire reaches wherever the wind already passed and blew down whatever trees, cars, buildings, people, you know, everything is a destructive force, godlike power. It's Jeremiah 51:2. And I will send unto Babylon fanners. Going into the ancient world, when you wanted to heat up a furnace, you would fan it. You would put more oxygen into it. But this land is already filled with the fuel. You people are fuel for the fire. Also, the gas in this land, the oil, the volcano, our Yellowstone. This place is set for the taking. All right. It said the wicked is wrapped like tow to be burned. The tow is like that rope that you see on the dynamite from the old Looney Tunes cartoons. That's what tow is. And the Lord said the wicked is like tow already wrapped together, ready to be burned. Then YAHWASHI stated in a parable that the wicked is going to be gathered up into bundles and burned. See that? It all comes together. It says, and will send unto Babylon fanners that shall fan her. Shall empty her land. These missiles going to empty the land. Just as an army raiding a town or a city or land, they're spoiling it. They're taking everything. They're leaving none. They're emptying out the land. These missiles, along with the laser fire from the ships, is going to empty out this land. It's going to make it utterly desolate. It says, and shall empty her land, for in the day of trouble, they shall be against her round about, these missiles. All right. Against him that bendeth, let the archer bend his bow. All nations that have nuclear capability. It says, and against him that lifteth himself up in his brigandine, and spare ye not her young men. Destroy ye utterly all her hosts. Now let's get this in the NLT. Don't let the archers put on their armor or draw their bows. Don't spare even her best soldiers. Let her army be completely destroyed. Woo! That's it. Now we're going to get that word brigandine. Let me play the clip. That's it, man. It went through his armor, got in there, man. But let's go into this word brigandine, and brothers gonna be surprised. You know, brothers, apostles, the elders, they already know what this word means, or may not know. But hey, that's why our apostles have always told us to go into the words. It makes the breakdown and you reading of the scriptures even that much more keen. Like, whoa, okay, going all the way into it. This is H5630. The word there for brigandine is sarayan. Let's see what it means. Sarayan, armor. Didn't my man Achilles have armor on? He even had footwear, but it still passed through that arrow, man. And then it got through armor. So it said, even he that lifted himself up. See, Babylon, America, they're so proud. Their own pride has deceived them. Even those ugly ass rats in our land, the small hats, their pride is going to deceive them as well. To hell with your missile defense system. The Lord is going to utterly break it and shake it to nothing and destroy it. Nothing is going to stop the Lord's determination. Even if you do got the armor, that just as the arrows got through to my man Achilles, those arrows, those nuclear weapons is going to get through your goddamn defense systems and utterly destroy you. It says a coat of mail. You go into the dark ages, they had those whole coats of iron and mail where nothing can really get through, a sword, an axe, you know, or an arrow. But it had to have severe force coming into that chain mail or the armor to actually pierce or get through or even make maybe even a dent in that armor. But hey, the Lord is letting you know, nah, the arrows is going to get through. It says, let him raise himself in his armor. So the Lord is like, all right, well, raise yourself in your armor and see if my arrows don't get through. All right, man, they're going to get through. All right. Now, this is the book of Zephaniah. All right. Let me get up out of there. Let's go back there. Now, this is the Lord speaking against Moab and Ammon, which they're going to get hit with missiles as well. China's going to get hit. Japan is going to get hit. All these places that have nuclear capability, yeah, they're going to fire their arrows on America, but America has its own arsenal, and they're going to fire back at these nations as well. This is Zephaniah 2 and 9. Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord, Yahweh Bashem Shav, host of armies, because the missiles are the Lord's army, the power of Israel, surely Moab shall be as Sodom. We already know how Sodom went out with fire raining from heaven, and the children of Ammon as Gomorrah. Man. Even the breeding of nettles and salt pits and a perpetual desolation, the residue of my people, the elect, shall spoil them. and the remnant of my people shall possess them, because those that are left, they're going to be slaves. Alright? Ooh, man. Zephaniah 2:13. And he will stretch out his hand against the north country being America, and destroy Assyria, another name for America is Assyria, and will make Nineveh, another name for America, a desolation, and dry like a wilderness. Ooh, man. So much can be said. So much to be said. Man, but let's finally get into this article, man. I could keep on going, man. I still got Joel 2 to really jump into. But we'll see if we can get to it. But this is the CSIS, all right, going into the semiconductors, which is for the National Defense of America, all right, on their digital system. And where the semiconductor chips are produced at an alarming rate is Taiwan. That's why it is a strategic and key place to protect for the U.S. at least. And that's why it's a strategic place for the Chinese to seize and take control of. But in order for those semiconductors to run properly, they need neon gases from Ukraine. And that's why Ukraine also is a place that the U.S. sees as a place of great importance. That's why they're financing the war going on over there in the Ukraine. All right. So it all makes sense. Shout out to double honors. First and foremost, to the apostles, the Apostle Tahar, Apostle Gabar, Apostle Ramlav, and Apostle Raka. Preferably, the Apostle Tahar brought this out at an after camp breakdown of Joel 3. All right, putting the brothers on the spot and asking them, why is Ukraine and Taiwan so needed? This is the reason why, because they have the two things that can power what these semiconductors are capable to do to protect the U.S. from outside forces. All right. It says all major U.S. defense systems and platforms rely on semiconductors for their performance. Consequently, the erosion of U.S. capabilities in microelectronics is a direct threat to the United States' ability to defend itself and its allies. Moreover, the U.S. civilian economy is deeply dependent on semiconductor based platform for its daily operations. We know this system is going to go digital soon enough. And that's why this man Biden, I say maybe a year back or a little less or more, he brought all these chips. You know, with the government spending, he bought, I forgot how many millions of chips. But without those semiconductors and without that those neon gases to power these semiconductors, those chips are really of no use that powers these cars and day-to-day operations, as we just read. So it has to get to a point where this digital system is going to be implemented and pushed. And right when that occurs, the war is going to break out. And it makes a lot of sense, because the two major places that have the materials needed to have the United States' ability to defend itself run properly are in two lands that are hostile at this time against the U.S. All right. Ukraine being in the backyard of Russia and Taiwan being in the backyard of China. China, like my man Trump says. It says the U.S. civilian economy is deeply dependent on semiconductor-based platforms for its daily operations, ensuring U.S. leadership in semiconductor technology and securing the integrity of the value chains that design, manufacture, package, and distribute these chips are perhaps the preeminent economic and national security concerns of the modern era. Of course, U.S. leaders have recognized the nexus between semiconductors and national security for decades. In the mid-1980s, President Reagan articulated the need to retain U.S. global leadership in chips to counter the Soviet bloc's numerically superior military forces through smart systems driven by semiconductors. So they just proved that the Soviets were far ahead of them. But in order for them to be even more advanced and above the Soviets, which are the Russians, they had to go into smart systems driven by the semiconductors, satellites, stealth aircraft like the stealth bombers that they have, cruise missiles that they can shoot from their battleships, warships, subs, all right, in the different silos, all right? So these things are needed, especially for the American military and for its national defense. Praise you the Lord. The Lord has set this place up. Babylon is set up. You're not aware. They are taken. Taken and they are unaware. Let's get that in Jeremiah. Reading on, it says, stealth aircraft, cruise missiles, and the like. Today, the United States faces an even greater challenge. It is confronted by a geopolitical rival that is stronger economically and technologically than the Soviet Union era was, or ever was, Salakia. Which I believe they're talking about China, but they may not even name them. Or it might be actual Russia, but they're just not known as the Soviets or the USSR, but it's the same old Russia. All right. But the Lord is putting the hooks back into their jaws to hate Babylon as they did in the 1950s, 60s, on down until when they fell apart in the late 80s. But now they're back at full power. And now the Lord is going to unleash the bear from that north country, which is Russia, against the north, which is America. Or a nation from the north, which is Russia, shall come against the north country, all right, which is America. And you have to know how to differentiate when it's talking about Russia and America, because they're both known as north. One is in the northeast and the other one is in the northwest. All right, so taken. Let's get it in Jeremiah. Brothers, trying to get all these good scripts. All right. Ooh, man, that one's good. Jeremiah 50 and 45. Therefore, hear ye the counsel of the Lord Yahweh, that he have taken against Babylon, America, and his purposes, that he hath purposed against the land of the Chaldeans, which are at this time the bankers. The Chaldeans of old were the sorcerers and magis that were the real rulers of the land behind the face of the king and his council or his king's court. But now these Chaldeans, these bankers, are really behind everything that's going on in the world, leading it into war, financing both sides. But yet the Lord hath purposed against Babylon to destroy it and to draw them out by way of their ally, even the small hats that are in our land. Amalek says, surely the least of the flock shall draw them out, all the nations. First and foremost, America. Surely he shall make their habitation where they live desolate with them. Not only the habitation of America is going to be destroyed, but also the habitation of the least of the flock, those small hats. Our land is going to be hit. All right. Let's see here. Yep. All right. Now we're unaware they are taken. Bear with me. Oh, yep, there it is. Jeremiah 50 and 24. I have laid a snare for thee, a trap. Thou art also taken, O Babylon, America, and thou was not aware. Thou art found and also caught because thou hast striven against the Lord, Yahweh Shemashai. Jeremiah 50 and 9. For lo, I will raise and cause to come up against Babylon, America, an assembly of great nations, beginning with Russia, the BRICS nations, and the other nations that are going to be joined with them from the north country, Russia, and they shall set themselves in array, prepare war against America, and let it be known that they're preparing war. Because when you set up an array in the ancient world, the nation that was being attacked knew, oh yeah, war is here, because they're setting themselves in array to come and attack. It says against her, the her being America, from thence she shall be taken. Their arrow shall be as of a mighty expert man. None shall return in vain. The missiles. Let's read the rest of this article. Let's keep going. It says, at the same time, the United States is struggling to halt and reverse the loss of its leading capabilities in manufacturing microelectronics. The recent shortage of automotive chips has driven home the damage that the steady erosion of capabilities in chip manufacturing can inflict on the U.S. civilian economy, it is equally important to appreciate the national defense implications of recent adverse trends. The current chip legislation, which at this writing is pending reconciliation in Congress, represents the most comprehensive program of federal support ever undertaken to ensure the viability of a domestic semiconductor industry, that is, an industry whose critical functions are located within the geography of the United States. The legislation is both essential and overdue. Despite the dwindling number of critics who oppose the legislation as industrial policy, federal measures to ensure the existence of a robust domestic commercial semiconductor industry, as President Reagan recognized long ago, are vital to U.S. national defense and to the strength and resilience of the U.S. national economy, because they all know it's going to go digital eventually. So this is all, man, everything is hanging in the balance. It's all on the line here. It says declining onshore capabilities. Oh, man. In terms of onshore capabilities, the U.S. semiconductor industry now has significant gaps in its production chain. The United States remains the unchallenged world leader in semiconductor design, controlling about 85% of the world market for electronic design automation, EDA, tools which are necessary for the design of the most advanced chips. However, there are factors to consider, such as U.S.-based chip manufacturing has declined to around 10% of the world total and lacks the onshore capability to make the most advanced devices at the 7 and 5 nanometer NM nodes. U.S. firms depend on sources in Taiwan and South Korea for production of their most sophisticated designs. So there you go. There it is. All right, now let me get... real quick, blue letter. Let's move this article up here. And we're going to move that right there. And we're going to move this over here. And we're going to keep reading into this article. Let's get up out of there. So these missiles are going to penetrate even the armor, even him that lifted himself up in his brigadine. They ain't going to spare any of the arrows. Let's keep reading. Says they will fall dead in the land of the Babylonians, slashed to death in her streets. When the missiles hit, none shall be spared, old nor young, nor the fruit of the womb, nor anybody. It says they shall not spare children. All right. Is going into the Medes in the book of Isaiah 13. Yeah, man. Shall not spare the fruit of the womb. It says verse 5, Israel have not been forsaken, nor Judah of his God. Of the Lord YAHAWASHI MASHAI of hosts, though their land was filled with sin against the Holy One of Israel. NLT, for the Lord of heaven's armies has not abandoned Israel and Judah. He is still their God, even though their land was filled with sin against the Holy One of Israel. Now, this is a command to us. Flee out of the midst of Babylon spiritually and deliver every man his soul. Be not cut off in her iniquity. But this is the time of the Lord, YAHAWASHI MASHAI's vengeance. He will render unto her a recompense. Verse 6, NLT, flee from Babylon, America. Save yourselves. Don't get trapped in her punishment. It is the Lord, YAHAWASHI MASHAI's time for vengeance. He will repay her in full. Woo! Says Babylon have been a golden cup in the Lord's hand that made all the earth drunken. The nations have drunk of her wine, which is her philosophies. Therefore, the nations are mad. The nations are gearing up. They're mad. They're going insane. All right, with military buildup. And in that time when the missiles fly, they're going to be as insane. All right. It says Babylon has been a gold cup in the Lord YAHAWASHI MASHAI's hand, a cup that made the whole earth drunk. The nations drank Babylon's wine, and it drove them all mad. Babylon is suddenly fallen and destroyed. Howl for her, take balm for her pain, if so be she may be healed. NLT, but suddenly Babylon too is fallen. Weep for her, give her medicine, perhaps she can yet be healed, which she cannot. we would have healed Babylon, but she is not healed. Forsake her and let us go, everyone, into his own land. So a Jake would think, oh, no, this place is good. You know, I'm trying to build, you know. But nah, the Lord is telling you this place is pretty much done. Forsake her. The elect will forsake this place. All right? Troy is fallen. All right? It says, we would have healed Babylon, but she is not healed. All right? It says, reading on, it says, and let us go everyone into his own land. These other nations are leaving, going into their own lands, getting with their own people. For a judgment reached unto heaven and is lifted up even to the skies. We would have helped her if we could, but nothing can save her now. Let her go. Abandon her. Return now to your own land, for her punishment reaches the heavens. See, the nations are going to return to their own lands. We as a people cannot return to our land because it's going to be hit. We have to wait on our Lord to deliver us and bring us back into our land. All right, it says, return now to your own land, for her punishment reaches to the heavens. It is so great it cannot be measured. It says, the Lord have brought forth our righteousness. Come, let us declare in Zion the work of the Lord, our power. That's it. It says, the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai has vindicated us. Come, let us announce in Jerusalem everything the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai, our God, has done. Going back into the arrows again, it just never ends. It never stops. Jeremiah 51 and 11. Make bright the arrows, gather the shields. These are the nations gearing up for war, arming themselves to the teeth. It says, the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai have raised up the spirit of the king of the Medes, which is the Russians, for his device is against Babylon, America, to destroy it, because it is the vengeance of the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai, the vengeance of his temple. And the reason the Lord has vengeance against this particular place and this nation and its people, being the Edomites, the rulers of this nation, is because they destroyed the Lord's temple. Not once, but twice. All right? So sharpen the arrows, which is nuclear missiles, the capability. That's why there's constant tests. Lift up the shields, for the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai has inspired the kings of the Medes from the Soviet era, even on down to now, to Putin. It says, for the Lord Yahweh Bashimashai has inspired the kings of the Medes to march against Babylon, hence the BRICS nations, and destroy her. This is his vengeance against those who desecrated his temple. All right, and let's get that real quick. Just the precept to that of why the Lord is going to destroy, you know, Edom, preferably because he destroyed the Lord's temple. And it is recorded. The Romans destroyed the second temple during the time of the Roman Jewish wars, as they call them. But who destroyed the temple originally, the one that Solomon built? The Edomites, during a time that the Babylonians under Nebuchadnezzar, who were Assyrians, made Judea desolate. This is 1 Esdras 4 and 44. And to send away all the vessels that were taken away out of Jerusalem, which Cyrus set apart when he vowed to destroy Babylon, which is the ancient Babylon, to send them again thither back to our land. That also thou also hast vowed to build up the temple which the Edomites burned when Judea was made desolate by the Chaldees. That's why the Lord says the vengeance, his vengeance, even the vengeance of his temple. See, they burned our temple and looted it. The Lord is going to loot this land by way of the missiles and burn it. Poetic justice. Back in the article up top, it says the United States has very little onshore capabilities for the outsourced assembly, testing and packaging, OSAT, of semiconductor devices, holding less than a 5% share of these essential functions, with most OSAT operations conducted in Taiwan, China, and Singapore. But now China is trying to take what Taiwan has had for many years. All right, a keen knowledge and understanding of the chips and how they're manufactured. It says the disaggregation and offshoring of significant elements of the U.S. semiconductor production chain heightens risks relevant to national security, including the potential for intellectual property theft, the introduction of counterfeit devices, and the disruption of the far-flung and delicate chip supply chain by natural disasters or geopolitical conflicts. There it is. That's what we're in the cusp of, geopolitical conflict. AI challenge from China. These production chain gaps are problematic from a U.S. national security perspective. China has emerged as a major strategic challenger to the United States and is investing heavily in developing its military power and defense industrial base, placing a priority on overtaking the United States and its allies in semiconductor technology, as an independent commission established by Congress recently concluded. If a potential adversary bests the United States in semiconductors over the long term, or suddenly cuts off U.S. access to cutting-edge chips entirely, it could gain the upper hand in every domain of warfare. U.S. vulnerability is particularly acute with respect to the most advanced chips currently in production, which are essential to the creation and application of artificial intelligence, AI, intelligence generated by machines, which is expected to revolutionize warfare. China's leaders have set a goal to build a fully modern military by 2027 based on information intelligentization and mechanization, investing heavily in technical areas which support such an approach, such as AI, quantum computing, hypersonics and hypersonic missiles, and microelectronics, smart cities. AI enables computer systems to solve problems and address tasks that normally require human intelligence, ultimately at speeds and performance levels that vastly exceed those of humans. In the words of the Japanese National Institute of Defense Studies, as AI does not get fatigued, does not forget, and has no emotional fluctuation, AI is expected to be able to help commanders make decisions by processing large quantities of data quickly and accurately in a future war, according to U.S. Senator Mike Rounds, defending against AI capability adversaries operating at machine speeds without employing AI is an invitation to disaster. Human operators cannot outmatch multiple machines making thousands of decisions per second, coordinated across various systems, nor will they be able to counter an adversary's AI-enabled missile attack strike against communication satellites and infrastructure, or coordinated firepower strikes, drone swarms, cyber attacks, and other 21st century threats. For this reason, the U.S. Armed Forces' current technical edge over all potential adversaries could be lost within the next decade if they do not accelerate the adoption of AI across their missions. A massive AI-driven Chinese attack could overwhelm U.S. defenses. Woo, man, we could keep on going. But let me end it there. And with that, giving all praises, glory, and honor unto YAHAWAH, BAHASHAM, YAHAWASHI, BAHASHAM, RAWCHAA, QADASH, by whom we do function, double honors, unto my apostles, my elders, and my teachers at Great Millstone, that are ruling well and continue to do so. Salutations, peace, and blessings unto the hopeful elect, that house of David, to your brothers out there fighting this good fight of faith, keep it up, Shalawam. And to those that are addicted unto this ministry, I say Shalawam. Those willing, you have been edified. Until the next time I say Shalawam, I may come back to this article. It's just so juicy. And, come with it again. It may not be more of this series. Perhaps it might be a part four. But just expect more going into this topic of the missiles. You know, because I still got to get into Joel too. So it may actually be a part four. But, hey, Lord's will, you've been edified thus far. And with that, hey, I say Shalawam, giving all praises, glory, and honor unto YAHAWAH, BAHASHAM, YAHAWASHI, BAHASHAM RAWCHAA QADASH, the Holy Spirit, for whom we do function, double honors unto my apostles and teachers at Great Millstone that are ruling well and continue to do so. Salutations, peace, and blessings unto the hopeful elect, that house of David, 144,000, the governing body. And to you, I say Shalawam until the next time, on to the next one. Shalawam. Shalawam.